Printers are the worst of the worst. They struggle to connect to the Wi-Fi, they constantly have paper jams, and don't get me started on the ludicrous price of ink. It seems that printers are one of the few tech industries that have been completely left behind. I mean, you can buy full-on computers and smartphones for less than the price of a new printer, yet printers can't even do the one task that they're built for: printing. It's easy to blame the printer industry as a whole and say that printer companies are simply unimaginative and not innovative. But the issue with printers is a lot more deep-rooted than uninspired companies and lackluster products. The real reason printers are so crappy is due to decades of hyper-focus on maximizing revenue through one avenue, ink. It's not uncommon for printer ink to exceed $80 per ounce. For perspective, even human blood only costs $17 per ounce, and silver costs $34 per ounce. In fact, selling ink is so profitable that it accounted for 63% of all of HP Inc's profits in 2019. It wasn't always like this. In fact, 50 to 60 years ago, printers were the cream of the crop. They were the best that the tech world had to offer, and they worked beautifully. Back in the 1960s, Xerox literally made a commercial showcasing how even a chimpanzee could operate a photocopier. Printer operators were so insulted after this airing that Xerox would decide to cancel the commercial just one day later. But that doesn't take away from the message of the commercial. Printers were once easy enough for trained chimpanzees to use, but today, even trained rocket scientists at NASA can't figure out how to operate these darn things. So what happened? How did printers go from being the forefront of the tech industry and the entire business of one of the biggest companies in the world, Xerox, to being the laughingstock of the tech industry and the endless frustration of hundreds of millions of office workers around the world? Well, sit back and grab a stress ball, because this is exactly how printers became the bane of our existence. Taking a look back, printers are by no means a new invention. It's theorized that printers may date as far back as 3500 BC to the Persians and Mesopotamians, who used cylinders to seal documents similar to what we do today. But the modern printing press didn't come around till the year 1440 when a German goldsmith named Johannes Gutenberg invented the movable type printing press. This was a true revolution, as the alternative was hand printing, which was limited to about 40 pages per day. Gutenberg's printing press put that number to shame, as it could produce 3,600 pages every single day. Over the next couple hundred years, the printing press became the gold standard for printing religious literature, newspapers, and books. Eventually, moving into the 1990s, there arose a new purpose for printing. People and corporations alike needed an easy way to copy existing documents at a small scale. They wanted to have additional copies of their bond and land certificates and their employment contract. But while the printing press was great at replicating a given piece of text like a Bible at scale, it wasn't all that great when it came to replicating individual documents and pages. Chester Carlson, a law student in the late 1930s, knew this pain all too well. You see, Chester couldn't afford to buy law books outright, so he would go to the library and painstakingly transcribe books onto sheets of paper. It was during one of these arduous copying sessions that he came across a scientific article by a Hungarian physicist named Paul Szeleny. Szeleny loosely described how you could use physics and, more specifically, electrophotography to duplicate documents more effectively. Carlson would begin trying to do electrophotography in his apartment, which led to a bunch of smoke, odd aromas, and even explosions. His neighbors probably suspected that he was smoking up something else, but Carlson persisted, and with the help of a friend, he would produce the following piece of text on October 22, 1938. Carlson was sure to patent this technology as soon as possible, and eventually he would partner with an up-and-coming company called the Halloyd Company. Together, they would create what we all know as Xerox today, but it was by no means an easy road. There was one major flaw with Carlson's invention. It was extraordinarily difficult to use. To be honest, I think we'd agree that electrophotography is probably easier than what we have today, but nonetheless, Carlson wanted to make it even easier. With backing from Xerox, Carlson would spend the next 21 years of his life trying to simplify each and every step of the process. And eventually in 1959, he would crack the code with the Xerox 914. This was the photocopier that was so easy to use that even a chimpanzee could use it, leading us into the golden era of printers. It may be hard to believe that printers were actually good at one point in time, so I'm sure you'll be relieved to hear that there was a massive caveat. Yes, the Xerox 914 and all of their photocopiers and printers that followed in the 60s, 70s, and even 80s were extraordinary. But it wasn't just the product that was extraordinary, it was also the price tag. The cost to make a Xerox 914 was simply so expensive that they didn't even try to sell it. Instead, they resorted to renting them out to local photocopying shops and offices for $25 per month or $238 today. Customers would have to pay 10 cents per copy or 96 cents today. Customers were also responsible for bringing their own paper and ink, which usually ran about 5 cents per copy. So all in, customers were paying over a dollar for every single page that they were printing. They would get their wish, but it would cost them an absolute fortune, coming in at $27,500. That's the same as $262,000 today. Photocopying was obviously not cheap, but it was more than worth it for important documents. I mean, the consequences of losing a land deed or a bond certificate were far worse than spending a dollar to have an extra copy. This proved to be insanely profitable for Xerox, and by 1970, Xerox would become a Fortune 100 company, which for a tech company was at the time unheard of. Xerox would invest a crap ton of money into research and development, and they actually came up with outstanding inventions. Not only would they make printers way better, but they would literally invent laptops, Ethernet, coding languages, text editors, and so much more. Now, they were so gung-ho on printers that they would end up giving all of these away, but that's a whole nother story. The point is that they were truly maintaining printers at the forefront of technology. But with that, they were also charging an arm and a leg and keeping up the renting model. For obvious reasons, having people pay per copy was a far better business decision for Xerox than trying to sell printers outright. But the reality was that things were changing once again. The need to photocopy was quickly being replaced by the need to print digital documents. Fortunately, it was Xerox who invented text editors and the ability to print text documents, but there was one problem. You had to go to a Xerox shop. If you were already using a computer cafe, it made sense to use the Xerox printer in the building. But while computer and internet cafes were super popular back in the day, people would eventually ditch these for personal computers in the comfort of their homes. And traveling to Xerox shops just to print stuff out quickly became an inconvenience. HP, Epson, and Canon were all watching this from the sidelines, and they decided that this was the perfect time to strike. The first mass-market residential inkjet printer was the HP DeskJet 500, which came out in 1988. Like its Xerox predecessors, this was truly an engineering masterpiece. In fact, it was so good that journalists like Scott Merrill were raving about it 22 years later. The HP DeskJet 500 was a workhorse. It never failed me in college or beyond. I printed a lot and never had a paper jam. Everything I threw at the DeskJet 500, it printed. Everything. But if printers were so good, what happened? Well, it turns out that asking people to pay $1,000 for a printer in 1988 was a pretty large ask. With budget computer brands like Dell popping up, you could literally buy an entire computer for that price. So why would you spend the same amount on just getting a printing machine? If these companies really wanted to create a personal printer market, they had to make printers cheaper. Way cheaper. But this was much easier said than done. Just because computers offered a better value for your money didn't mean that it was any cheaper to design or produce printers. But that was irrelevant to end consumers. If you wanted to appeal to them, it was up to you to figure out how to make printers cheap enough for everyday people. With all these mega companies working on this, you would think that some engineer somewhere would make a monumental breakthrough that substantially simplified printers and made them far cheaper. But this never happened. Instead, printer manufacturers just decided to sell printers for a loss. They figured that they could just make the money on the ink, and somehow, 30 years later, they're still using the same strategy, and they've only gotten more aggressive. The reason that printers are affordable today is not because they're cheaper to make, but because companies are willing to take bigger and bigger losses. But with that being said, when you're selling a product for a loss, you're naturally not going to invest into R&D, testing, reliability, or ease of use. Instead, you're gonna put out an MVP or a minimum viable product, and this is the reality of the entire consumer printer industry today. The reason printers are so bad is because every company is trying to shrink an extremely complex product into an MVP. I mean, just think about it. A printer has to put millions of dots onto a piece of paper within a matter of seconds. There's no way that such a complex product can work as an MVP that's sold for a loss. Printer companies should be thinking about how to engineer better printers, but given that that's not where the money is, printer companies have been spending all of their efforts on how to sell as much ink as possible, and this has led to some pretty anti-consumer inventions. Some companies will straight up prevent you from using counterfeit ink through software, but even if they don't go that far, they'll make sure that you feel the pain. For example, the print heads of many printers are actually located on the ink cartridge. This means that the quality of your print will only be as good as the ink you buy. So, if you bought some counterfeit cartridges and noticed that the quality went down substantially, this is probably why. Looking forward, the future of printers isn't looking any brighter because printers as a whole are going extinct. Here's the thing, one of the main reasons that printers became so popular in the first place was because of trust. People didn't trust computers as much as they trusted themselves. They wanted hard copies of important documents, they wanted real signatures that felt authentic. But today, printers are becoming irrelevant for the exact same reason, trust. This time though, it's themselves that people don't trust. People and companies alike don't want to have filing cabinets full of documents. They don't want to hold on to 200-page contracts that are fatter than books. And they trust the cloud and 7 backups across the world more than a singular hard copy. At this point, hard copies are more of a formality than anything. Everything from buying a house to completing an acquisition can be done completely digitally, and this is what people actually prefer. So, with that being said, it doesn't make sense for anyone to double down on the printer industry and try to make it better. The more likely scenario is that printers will go extinct, and the last memory that we'll have of them is good riddance. Do you hate printers? Comment that down below. Also, drop a like if you trust computers more than yourself. And of course, consider checking out our Discord community to suggest future video ideas, and consider subscribing to see more questions logically answered. But until then, I'm Hari, and I'll see you guys on the next one.